During the last glaciation, ice was moving so fast and so forcefully that these proglacial sands, originally deposited in horizontal layers, were deformed by the overriding ice into these beautiful chevron folds. Understanding the speed of glacier advance and retreat is important if you are in front of a surging glacier or trying to survive rapid melting. Glacier velocity is determined by radiocarbon dating of fossil trees and other plants buried by glacial sediments at sites along the glacier's path. Spruce needles were washed from the gray layer of sand and provides one data point for this reconstruction. This next site, tree stumps were drowned by a proglacial lake and buried by varved lake sediment and thence by till. This site is located near the southernmost extent of the last glaciers at Charleston, Illinois. Putting these dated sites on a time-space diagram, time is on the y-axis and the distance is on the x-axis. And it tells us that the ice initially cruised along at about 3 kilometers per year, about 3 times faster than modern ice streams in Antarctica. The glacier slowed down significantly as it piled up debris at its terminus. So much for the advance. Now we can learn about glacial retreat. One way is to analyze fossils archived in glacial donuts, landforms that are locally abundant throughout glaciated mid-America. These active ice wall lakes in Alaska may eventually look something like our ice wall lake plains. Just fill these holes in the ice with sediment and melt the ice-cored uplands, and voila, a landscape that is covered with giant pancakes. Such as these features shown on a hillshade map of LIDAR data from northeastern Illinois. New sediment cores that we got just last week suggest that the prominent rims were formed by late-stage squeezing of saturated lake sediment and melt-out till. Ice wall lake plains are found throughout Illinois. They also occur elsewhere in the Midwest, in Scandinavia, Eastern Europe, Argentina, and possibly on Mars. An early theory regarding the formation of glacial donuts was by the melting of pingos, volcano-like structures formed by debris and permafrost, which have been thrust up by sub-permafrost groundwater. This block diagram is probably a more reasonable depiction of how they form, but there are many caveats involving their genesis and late-stage modifications that we have yet to learn about. The best modern analogs of Illinois' ice wall lakes occur in the Tamir Peninsula, the northernmost part of Asia. These lakes are nested in dead ice permafrost with a capping debris-rich active layer, complete with flowering plants slumping into the lake. Back in Illinois, we now know how to recognize ice wall lake plains from shaded relief maps and incorporate them into our surficial geology maps. Sediment cores are essential to verify interpretations. The typical succession includes a lag of fossiliferous sand and gravel and rhythmically bedded fines, which are mantled by weathered and fossil-free dimicton and till and silt. Transects of closely spaced sediment cores and geophysical data prove the continuity and overall architecture of the sediment layers. Plant fossils are key in this research because they can yield radiocarbon ages. This example, which is coming up, shows the state of preservation of leaves and calyxes of a plant called snowbed willow, and microcrustacean ostracods are also found in the sediment. The ages determined from a suite of ice wall lake plains allows me to plot a detailed deglacial history of the Lake Michigan low. The rates of deglaciation are given here and are similar to rates of deglaciation measured on modern glaciers. Dates from strategically located ice wall lake plains can determine when the Lake Michigan lobe interacted with its neighboring lobes. The age of these fossil leaves tell me when the Lake Michigan lobe just stopped interacting with the Green Bay lobe to the north. These willow and berry leaves not only make a nasty pot of tea, but their radiocarbon age reveals when the Lake Michigan lobe stopped butting heads with the Huron Erie lobe in northeastern Illinois. So for context, in my final slide, the age of the first pile of leaves indicates when the Lake Michigan lobe was interacting with the Green Bay lobe, and the age of the second pile of leaves indicates when the Lake Michigan lobe was influenced by the Huron-Erie lobe.